Hi, this is Tony Tamasi with NVIDIA. We've spoken before about the importance of high frame rate in competitive games. Today, we're going to talk to you about the importance of low latency in competitive gaming. To understand the importance of latency, let's break down the two types of latency. The first is network latency, which is the time it takes your computer to communicate with the servers, and those servers determine things like hit detection and position in competitive games. In this example here, the player takes a shot, and there's a noticeable delay between that shot and the ultimate kill confirmation. That delay is network latency, also known as lag. The second type of latency is local or system latency, which is things like input processing, your game engine, rendering, and ultimately display. What we have here is a user firing a gun. To fire the gun, he's going to click a mouse. On the lower right-hand side of the screen, you'll see an LED that's lit up. That LED will go off when he fires the gun. The delay between the light going off and the muzzle flash on the screen is system latency. That delay is also called motion to photon or click to muzzle flash. Delays between your input and what you see on the screen make it difficult to aim, which hurts your ability to compete. Putting those two concepts together, let's talk about peeker's advantage, another scenario common in multiplayer games. Peeker's advantage is when the attacker typically is able to see the defender by working an angle first, and the defender has to wait for all the latencies to accumulate before he can see the attacker. On the left-hand side is a system with low system latency, and on the right-hand side is a system with high system latency. Both of them have the same network latency. As you can see here, the system with the high system latency is at a disadvantage compared to the system on the left. That user gets a much greater advantage in terms of visibility. If we reverse the scenario and take a look at it from the defender's perspective, you can see that with a faster system latency, it actually mitigates some of that peeker's advantage, giving them the opportunity to take that shot first. The first component of latency is going to be your input latency or your peripheral latency. Typically, this is your mouse and your keyboard. The second component is going to be your input sampling. That's the computer itself receiving inputs from your input devices and then sending them to the game for processing for things like input and position. After that becomes the game engine itself, the game latency, things like visual effects, audio, local simulations, visibility, that sort of thing. The next component after that is your rendering latency. This is composed of your render queue and the GPU actually producing the frames. The final piece of that is compositing. That's the Windows compositor taking the frame and scheduling it to be composited with other windows. Ideally, you would avoid compositing by running in a full screen exclusive mode. The sum of these is your PC latency. The final component is your display latency, which is comprised of three things. The scanout rate, which is the time it takes to scan the frame buffer that your GPU has rendered into the display. This is impacted by your display's refresh rate or its hertz. The faster the rate, the shorter that time. The second component is your display processing. This can be things like HDR processing or fancy temporal processing. This can actually be a substantial amount of time as some TVs can accumulate multiple frames. And the third component is your pixel response time, also known as your gray to gray. This is the time it takes a pixel to respond and change color when it's given an input. The sum of those is your display latency. Putting all those components together, you get your end-to-end system latency. In this simplified GPU-bound pipeline, we're going to break down some of the components that comprise latency. On the y-axis, we show the various events in latency, and on the x-axis is time moving from left to right. You can track a frame through the pipeline by following a single color from the top to the bottom, starting with input latency, to game engine, to the render queue, to GPU rendering, and ultimately to display. The second component to notice is the render queue. There's actually two frames being queued between the game engine and the ultimate GPU work on the renderer. That frame queue is latency. Those frames are there because the GPU is not clearing frames as fast as the CPU can present it. That's a GPU-limited scenario. That latency in the render queue contributes to the overall end-to-end latency. The final thing to take note of is the CPU work and its relationship to the GPU. In a GPU-bound scenario, the CPU must wait for a prior frame to complete before it is allowed to continue with producing the next frame. NVIDIA's Reflex SDK allows developers to optimize the latency of their game pipeline in a couple of unique ways. The first is it allows them to eliminate that render queue entirely, and you notice on this diagram there's no frames queued up for the GPU, which reduces the end-to-end system latency. The second thing is it allows the CPU work to be aligned just in time with the rendering so that the rendering gets the most up-to-date information possible from the game engine before it renders. At the other end of the spectrum is a CPU-limited game. In this scenario, the CPU is actually slower than the GPU, which means the latency is small and there is no render queue because the GPU is able to consume the frames faster than the CPU can actually produce them. You may wonder, in a CPU-bound scenario, does the GPU make any difference at all? And the answer is yes. Even though the CPU is your limiting factor, the GPU's render time is an overall contributor to your latency. A faster GPU reduces that render time, reducing the overall latency even though you're CPU limited. Why does this all matter? As you can see on the chart here, lower latencies can absolutely improve your mechanical skill. As you reduce your latencies, your performance can improve. Looking at some common gaming configurations, in this case with Fortnite, you can see there's quite a range of latencies. If you look at a game console playing Fortnite, your typical latency is right around 100 milliseconds. Your average PC is probably similar when it's running at 60 Hz. If you do some optimizations of that PC to improve things, you can cut the latency about in half. And if you push the envelope with faster hardware, a faster display, and state-of-the-art software optimizations, you can drive the latencies on a PC with Fortnite to as low as 15 milliseconds. We hope you found today's talk informative. For more information, please check out our in-depth article on latency, as well as our latency optimization guide, both of which are linked below. Thanks for watching.